Are you getting this? Teaching, Preaching, and Storytelling. Written and read by Robert Fergusson. Introduction. I own an old and dog-eared copy of Beatrix Potter's book, The Story of the Fierce Bad Rabbit. It's a book I've kept since I was a child, and despite its poor condition, I intend to pass it on to my children's children. Why do I still have it? Because it's one of the few reminders of my father that I possess. I was only 8 years old when he died, but I still remember him reading stories to me before bed. In my innocence, I'd always assumed he read this particular story to me because it was about farming and hunting rabbits, both of which he enjoyed doing. Now that I'm older and have children and grandchildren of my own, I suspect he chose the story because it was so short. Fewer words meant less time to put me to bed. At the time, however, I was blissfully unaware of its brevity. "Dad, could you please tell us a story?" This is a question I used to hear on a daily basis when my children were young. I was often asked during meal times. Of course, I would immediately embark on a tale of adventure and use the props that were available on the table. Sally the Salt Shaker and Peter the Pepper Pot were two of my children's favourite table characters. I would invariably make up a story and follow whatever direction the characters would lead me. On one occasion, Peter and Sally went on a trip across the Atlantic on an ocean liner. During the course of the journey, Sally fell overboard. With great effort, Peter managed to rescue her, but she lost some salt in the process. This, I explained, is why the Atlantic is so salty, and it's also why we need to be careful on boats. Now that I have grandchildren, little has changed. "Granddad, could you please tell us a story?" "Well," I tell them, "once upon a time, there was a goat named George." Or perhaps I will sit with them and begin to read. "Shadow Tail sat alone in the far corner of the cave." Maybe you've done something similar. But have you ever wondered why we tell stories at all? Why, for instance, did my father tell me stories at bedtime? And why is it that I want to pass stories on to my children's children? What is it about parenting that seems to compel us to use stories as a way to convey life lessons or illustrate the importance of moral values? Ever since the first human left a footprint in the dust, when fires served as meeting places and paint was daubed onto the walls of caves, stories have played a vital part in our cultural identity. Yet many of us have never bothered to ask why we tell them or how they work. Do you think it is time we revisited their importance? One reason they are significant is because, I believe, stories are woven into the fabric of humanity. Passing on who we are is part of our DNA. Perhaps this is best illustrated in the story of Israel recorded for us in the Bible. When the Israelites were given the laws of God, they were also provided with instructions about how to disseminate these laws. This included the phrase, "Impress them on your children." Generational legacy has always been vital to the people of God. This was accomplished in many ways: regular reading, memorization, conversation, and symbols, to name a few. But perhaps one of the most potent was through storytelling. The Israelites were required to tell stories. In the book of Deuteronomy, it says, "In the future, when your son asks you, 'What is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws the Lord our God has commanded you?' tell him, 'We were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand.'" Are you surprised, as I am, that the fragile framework of a story was chosen to hold something as weighty as a divine decree? What if the act of telling stories is more important than we originally thought? What is the story behind this? When you chose this book, did you ask yourself, what exactly is the this I'm supposed to get? If you did, let me tell you the story behind this. In 1968, I sat in a school classroom staring at a piece of paper that was just as blank as my mind. I held a teal-green fountain pen in my hand. It had an anxious tooth mark embedded into its side. Before that moment, I thought I was good at mathematics. But for the last hour, my teacher had attempted to teach a computer programming language to me. I had no idea what he was talking about. What was the purpose of it anyway? I'd never even seen a computer, let alone used one. I set my pen down on my desk and folded my arms. And then I made a decision, one that took years for me to undo. Since I didn't understand computers, I made up my mind I would never understand them. It was a pivotal moment in my life. My inability to comprehend this new technical language made me believe that I was worthless. I felt like a complete failure. I was also very angry with the teacher because he didn't help me get it. It's strange to say, but it was this negative experience, in retrospect, that eventually fueled my love of teaching. How? Because I am familiar with the discouragement that comes from not getting it. So now, I work very hard to do everything I can to keep others from feeling the way I did in that classroom. Many years later, when my own children were in school, my son asked me some questions about computers, but I was incapable of providing answers for him. It became apparent that I needed to remove the inner vow that I had made. So what did I do? I swallowed my pride and enrolled in a computer course taught by my son's computer teacher. It wasn't long before I finally got it. Why have I written this? Maybe you can't relate to my story. Maybe you've never struggled with the technical side of computers. However, I'm sure there have been occasions in your life when you failed to understand an idea or were unable to explain a concept to someone. Perhaps you also felt a failure. If you have, I believe this book will help you get it. Have you noticed how all teachers appear to have annoying habits? After over 40 years of teaching, I have many of them. My nose scratching, for instance. My misuse of the phrase, the other day. The fact that I regularly start my messages with a date. But the habit I'm best known for is my consistent use of the phrase, are you getting this? A friend used to say to me, if you ever write a book on teaching, you should call it, are you getting this? And so I have. My habit may be annoying on occasion, but at least I'm in good company. Even the greatest teacher himself, Jesus Christ, said something similar to his disciples. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. Yes, they replied. Personally, I think they lied. I don't think they got it at all. It's this failure of the disciples to get it, which is the inspiration for this book. What is this? Not every teacher may ask the question, are you getting this? However, the goal that good teachers have remains the same. They want their students to grasp the lessons they teach. My wife, Amanda, a teacher and a trained musician, says to her students, are you hearing this? She is concerned with sound. As a teacher and a trained biologist,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.